Hello, welcome to Lady Applejack Speaks VA, a VA channel here on YouTube that focuses on the Netflix series Stranger Things. I hope all my Stranger Things are having a lovely hump day, hump night, whatever. We're halfway through the week. Thank God. I want this week to be over so bad. But anyhow, I am back with a new episode, and the new episode is for Series 3. Don't Stop Believing, where we follow the storyline of Eddie Munson and Liz Carver, the younger biological sister of, almost said Eddie, I usually try, goodness gracious, the younger biological sister of Jason Carver. Yay, lucky her, he's a real winner. Anyhow, so it follows their storyline, where they had been friends in middle school. They'd kind of drifted apart when Eddie went over to the high school. Now they're kind of like enemies, and it's possibly going to lead to some more stuff. Some good stuff. Goody stuff, yeah. So, that's where we're at with it. And this is episode 2 of the Don't Stop Believing series. The episode date is going to be August 30th, 1985, which fell on a Friday night. This will be right after the football game. And their rating on here is kind of different than what I usually do. There's a reason, and I'll explain that. It's rated R for strong language, and it has trigger warnings. So there's two trigger warnings. One's physical violence. The other is SA attempt. So there is an assault attempt in this. So listener discretion is strongly advised. 17 plus, obviously. But if you listen to it and you're under the age of 17, I'm not Steve Harrington. I can't come to your door and like harass you about it. And I'm not going to. So just take that for what you will. If you don't want to listen to the episode, obviously, for the trigger warnings, that's okay. Just go over to my Instagram and send me a DM saying, hey, I need an episode summary for Series 3, Episode 2. I'll know what you're talking about. I'm going to leave my handles in the description box and at the end of this video. And let's see, what else can I say about this? So obviously Eddie Munson and Liz Carver are the characters in question in this script. So their narratives are both in here. Part one, the first half of the script, is Liz Carver's point of view, and then the second is Eddie's point of view. Narrative wise, you could think of it as a fourth wall, or you could think of it as internal dialogue. There is another vocal person in this script. However, I want to keep a mystery until near the end. So there you go. The title of this episode is Let's Hear It for the Boy. That was a song released in 1984 by Denise Williams. And, yeah, I think that's all I got here. Sorry, my chair is it's squeaking like crazy. I don't know if you guys can hear it, but anyway. Without further ado, let's just jump into the episode. After the game, Eddie's point of view. I actually went to a football game to pick up Liz Carver. Neither of which I would have ever imagined doing in my wildest dreams. I kind of feel like a creeper right now, standing outside the locker room waiting for her. She said that she needed a shower and to change. That she didn't want to wear her uniform around a bunch of clumsy drunks. I guess that makes sense. Since this morning, I haven't been able to stop thinking about her. Well, scratch that. I'm lying. I caught myself thinking about her all summer. It all started when I saw her at a bonfire out by Lover's Lake. I had just finished up a deal and I was getting ready to leave. And then I saw her. She looked so far away in her thoughts, sitting by the lake on a tree stump. She was wearing a little yellow sundress with white flowers, I guess daisies, all over it. She had abandoned her wedge sandals so she could feel the sand between her toes. I know, that's weird. How would I know that? Well, I spent some of my best summers with this girl, and I remember we would come to the lake sometimes, and she always took off her shoes so she could feel the sand between her toes. She changed so much, and I'm not just talking about her weight. Everything had changed. She was more filled in. Not that tomboy that I remember from middle school. She was curvy in all the right places, and her hair, once frizzy and tomato red, was smooth as silk and auburn. It was hard to believe that this girl was the same girl that I would roughhouse in the fields by our homes. She looked so delicate. She didn't see me that night. I didn't have the balls to approach her, even though I really wanted to. I also know deep down that she was still pissed at me for moving on to high school and getting a new group of friends in the process. I guess I really can't blame her, but there is such a thing as a phone, and she could have called me at any point. She could have also stopped by Forest Hills. She knew where I lived. It works both ways. I shift uncomfortably as a few girls exit the locker room, chuckling to themselves as they pass me. How long does it take for her to get a fucking shower and get dressed? Fine, speak of the devil. The door of the locker room creaks open once more. And there she is. Her auburn hair is down like it was this morning, but she had added some curl to it. Honestly, I like it better than the ponytail that she simply had to wear for the pep rally and the game. Social conformity. Don't they know that's what's killing the kids? She's wearing a red knee-length dress that showed off her bare tan shoulders. With that, she's wearing a thick black belt and a pair of matching heels. The heels make her look incredible. She looks, well, she looks beautiful for someone who isn't looking forward to going out tonight. You look nice. Thanks. Are you ready? Yep, yep. The chariot awaits, m'lady. Here, let me take that bag from you. It looks... Oof. Oh, Jesus. Yeah, it's definitely heavy. What the hell do you got in here? The Russian army? No. Just, you know, my books, my uniform, shoes, pom-poms, blow dryer, curlers, makeup. Oh, okay. I get it. Basically, your entire house. Am I right? You know, Eddie, I can really carry my own bag. I don't find it that heavy at all. And I won't want to put you out, so. It's fine. Come on, let's go. Well, this is starting off to be a great evening. Jesus Christ, way to go, Munson. Piss her off before you even get to the party. Nice. I silently berate myself as we head towards my van. Andy, Sinclair, Carver, all of them pile into their trucks and speed off. Carver doesn't even bother to stick around to ensure that his sister has a ride. I roll my eyes and open the door for her. Ladies first. I'll put your bag in the back. Thanks. I pull open the sliding door of the back of the van and put her duffel bag inside, right behind her seat. I close that door, and then I run over to the driver's side and jump in, starting the engine. The radio comes to life, and it starts with Steve Perry's song, Oh Sherry, and it plays throughout the entire van. This makes Liz smile.
Should've been gone, knowing how I made you feel, and I should've been gone.
Okay, are you ready? Yes. All right. Judging by that smile on your face, I'm guessing this is one of your favorite songs. Kinda? I mean, it has to be, right? I mean, it's a rite of passage there. You know, with my name being... Well, my middle name being Sherry. They don't have that many songs for Lucetta's. Well, I think Lucetta is a prettier name, but that's just my opinion. Who knows, maybe someday I'll write a song about you so you can have your Lucetta song. Weren't you named after someone in your family? I felt like you told me that at one point.
Mm-hmm. My paternal grandmother. My parents were, you know, paying homage to her Italian roots. Well, I like it.
She bites her bottom lip, looking down at her lap. I reach into my vest pocket and pull out my lighter and a near empty pack of cigarettes. I pull one out of the pack with one hand and start bringing it up to my lips. That is, until she reaches over, yanking the cigarette from my lips
I watch as she snaps it in half and tosses it out the window. Hey! What the hell? I don't want to smell like cigarettes. This is a new dress and the stench lasts on this fabric. Besides, smoking is bad for you.
You know, for someone who doesn't have a ride, you are being a real tight ass.
And for someone that needs photos for their stupid corroded artery band, you are being a real prick.
Corroded coffin. The name, once more, say it with me loud and proud, is Corroded Coffin, Princess.
Don't call me that.
Don't act like an entitled bitch then, and I wouldn't.
Thank God this ride is almost over. Okay, you see that house right there? The one with all the cars? That's Andy's.
Okay. I'm assuming we aren't staying for long, right?
I don't know. Might drag this out a little bit. Yeah, I might drag this out a little bit just to piss you off.
You know what? The longer, the better. Come on, Princess.
Stop calling me that! Ow! Fuck! Jesus Christ.
I could tell this night was going to blow. Now I remember why I stopped making any effort to see her.
She is so... Oh, goddamn, she's so infuriating. 2 hours later, Liz's point of view. Eddie Munson is such a jerk. There, I said it. How the hell were we even friends? How were we even best friends? How did that happen? We're total opposites. He smokes, he drinks his weight in alcohol, and it just doesn't seem to faze him. And he's socially awkward. And he's totally okay with being a wallflower. Meanwhile, I'm trying to enjoy myself for once. When I come to these stupid parties with Jason, I'm always expected to stay sober. I never have fun. And finally in my high school career, I could at least have a little bit of fun. There's some silver linings to not going with Jason to these parties. I can't remember how many beers I had, thanks to Andy's hospitality. After I emptied my cup, each time I emptied my cup, he was quick to give me a full refill. My insides warmed with the drunken feeling that was coming over me. I lost track of Eddie. He had mentioned something about meeting up with someone to complete a deal. When I saw it was some girl in my junior class and that they were both seemingly having a ball and hitting it off well, I felt an unfamiliar feeling in the pit of my stomach. Was it jealousy? No, absolutely not. I'm not jealous. Especially with whatever Eddie Munson is doing. I'm not jealous. I'm just not. I down another beer and almost immediately I start feeling sick. Oh, no. no. This was a big mistake. A big, big mistake. Oh no. I tried to leave the kitchen, stumbling around until I feel some strong arms around my waist. Hey, Lizzie. Where do you think you're going? Andy. Hey, I gotta go. I gotta find my ride. Oh, God, I'm not feeling so good. Whoa. Hold on, little Carver. Shit. You look completely out of it. Come on. I'll take you someplace quiet. No. I just need to find... I need to find Eddie, my dungeon master. I didn't know you two were so close. No, we aren't. He hates my guts. Oh well. But yeah, he's given me a ride, so I need to find Ed's.
Hold up. How about I get you settled in that quiet room and I'll go find him. I promise.
Okay. But you have to find Ed's, okay? It's important. I don't feel good and I just don't feel good.
You established that. Sure. Without warning, Andy sweeps me up and throws me over his shoulder. I can feel my guts lurch in the process. I feel his right hand give my butt a squeeze.
Hey! Stop!
Oh, my bad, darling. hand must have slipped.
Soon, we're in a dark room. Well, with the exception of black lights. I see numerous football and basketball trophies lining a nearby shelf and posters of half-naked chicks washing cars pinned up to the wall.
He brought me to his room.
Hey, what's going
on? Here we go. Let's just lay you down to relax. I'll lay you right here on my bed. Isn't that comfortable?
I don't feel so good.
Relax, little Carver. Just chill.
Andy, where's Ed's?
Who cares about that freak? Honestly, he's probably off getting wasted. Now, come on. Let's make you a little more comfortable here.
Oh, why is the room spinning? Why is Andy taking off my belt? I ignore him at first, thinking he'll stop.
Feels nice, doesn't it?
got my belt off, but then, what is he doing? He starts pulling up the skirt of my dress. Oh, no. Oh, no. No, 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 no. Stop. Andy, please stop. I'm trying to push him off, but he's so much bigger than me. No. You look so gorgeous, little Carver. Oh, God, I've been waiting all summer for this. No. Stop it. Stop. Let me go. Relax, gorgeous. Trust me, you're gonna like this. No, no, please stop. Andy, let me go. Jesus Christ. You scratched me. Oh, fucking crazy little bitch. Now you're gonna get it. You're gonna really get it. Please stop. Stop, please. No, no, no. Stop it. No, no, please. Stop. Shut up. You know what? You wanted this, bitch. I know you've been all over me. All over me since you've come into the door. You're gonna get it now. Oh, fuck, you're gonna get so good.
Please. Stop, stop, please.
Get your goddamn hands off of her.
I watch in shock as Eddie grabs Andy by the shoulders, jerking him off of me. He slams Andy into a nearby wall, putting the blade of his pocket knife up to Andy's throat before Andy could even throw a punch. Andy is dumbfounded by this rare sight of Eddie Munson. Eddie Munson enraged.
What part of no didn't you understand, asshole?
She wanted it.
If a girl is crying like that, asking you to fucking stop, she doesn't want it. Now listen here, and you listen goddamn good, because I'm only going to say it once. You are to stay the fuck away from Lisetta. You aren't to look at her, talk to her, or even think about her. If I ever catch you even giving her a side glance, I swear to God that will hunt you down and tear you to shreds. Understood? Do you understand me? Yeah, man, whatever.
Eddie smirks, taking a step back from Andy, but leaving his pocket knife out for any sudden movements. I see a thin line of blood near Andy's Adam's apple. My God. How did Eddie cut him? I try to look away. Tears are still rolling down my cheeks, and I tug my belt back on and pull down my skirt of my dress. I hiccup between tears. I'm trying so hard not to throw up.
And one more thing, Andy, just so you're aware. Special K? Like the stuff you apparently laced Liz's beer with tonight? It can bring some serious jail time. combine it with attempted rape charges, well, that doesn't look so great on paper for colleges. Try not to do that again. Because if you do, you won't be so lucky. Hey, Liz, honey, hey, hey, look at me. It's okay. I got you. Let's get you out of here. Here, hold on to me. Wrap your arms around my neck. He scoops me up into his arms effortlessly, and immediately I feel safe. That earlier argument with him, all of that just fades away. It reminds me of all the times he would come to my rescue on the playground when Andy and the boys would torment me about my weight. I bury my face into the crook of his neck, forgetting all my past hurts and all my past animosity with him. I breathe him in. He smells of tobacco, sandalwood, and citrus. And it's all warm and familiar. He carries me out to the van, opening the passenger door and putting me into the seat. Buckles my seatbelt, and soon everything fades to black. Okay, that's the end of episode 2 for series 3. I really hope you guys enjoyed this. I know I'm kind of leaving you guys on a cliffhanger. What's new? But yeah, let me know in the comments below what you liked about this. And if you have requests for something that these two can do, or requests of any nature, feel free to leave those below too. I'm still taking an active list of requests. I just got to figure out how to weave them into series into the series as much as I can. So please bear with me. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up. And if you haven't subscribed yet and you are kind of interested in seeing where all this goes, feel free to hit that subscribe button and the notification button right beside it, and that will get you signed up for notifications on this channel. I want to just say a special thank you to all of you guys for your support. I believe the last time I checked, I had 580 followers, and I was blown away, like, just blown away. Now I have community posts, and I have these great people that like my work. So thank you so much for your support and your love. And special shout out once again to Lexi VA. Lexi VA is like my ride or die in the VA community, and I absolutely adore her. This particular series would have not even seen the light of day had it not been the fact that she had sent me some inspiration, and unbeknownst to her, it triggered something in me to write this series. So yes, thank you, Lexi. And if you guys aren't following her yet on TikTok, what are you waiting for? Go to your search engine, put in Lexi, L-E-X-I underscore V-A capital letters, and sign up to listen to her content. She's got some amazing content, you guys. Like, I feel like she puts my writing to shame because her descriptions and whatnot are so beautiful. I love her Clumsy series, but one that I think everybody needs to check out is her Billy Hargrove series. Now, the Billy Hargrove episodes that she has out there, guys, I was never a fan of Billy Hargrove, and I think a lot of it was just the fact that he was so mean to Max, but
Like, she sold me on Billy Hargrove. The way she writes Billy Hargrove, she makes him a character that you can easily love and easily appreciate. I think Lexi could probably write about the devil and it would sell me. I'll be like, okay, sign me up. So, yeah, go check out her work. It's really good. And she deserves all the love out there. So, as for my socials, everything is inside the description box. So if you want to follow me on TikTok or Instagram, you can. I am actually dropping some Easter eggs over onto that channel shortly after this one, after this video. So go check out the Easter eggs I drop off there. It will give you kind of an idea of what Liz was wearing and better describe it than what Eddie could describe it as. So go check that out. Say hi to me if you want. You can send me a DM. I don't bite. And yeah, that's all I got for you guys. I hope you enjoyed this, and I'll talk to you soon. Love you. Bye.